wisdom and truth without having ever taken the time to dig into research, it's embarrassing. I cannot keep up with the demand, the interest, the passion. That's why I created the Astro School. And you know what's really amazing? The amount of people who will go through my Astro School, actually take the information and the training that I'm putting out there, it's easily less than 10% of the people that sign up. People don't actually want to learn astrology because it's real work. It's real work. And it's not just heady intellectual work. That's the bias that always gets put on astrology. Oh, what are you going to be on your computer and learn about nature that way? Yeah, you can, because we're studying nature. That's what the birth chart is. It's a language that translates back to nature. When you learn the language, that's what you get to. So absolutely. And it's not just challenging because it's heady and intellectual. Learning real astrology is challenging because you're not going to be able to bypass from real life anymore. At all. It gets really, really, really clear. It gets clearer beyond what most people believe is possible to have in the form of clarity. Hence the isolation I speak to under this full moon. And if you caught my last year's full moon, certainly came from the same place. Again, a bit of a grouchy full moon. The way I run my business is designed to keep the fanfare, the fashion trend, the overexcitement, the blabbering about the certificate that you got while you don't actually have anything.
Control the course
floating heads bobbling around speaking this language that doesn't translate to anything.
We all
again, this is what I see easily is the majority of so-called astrologers.
He's a Republican.
Not even saying anything.
The environment around
and then people don't even have the discernment to recognize
I think
that they're not saying anything.
Are we ready to hear Alan?
So interesting about this time. How's my mic? Is it okay?
You're perfect, Alan.
Okay. So I'm really happy to be here. So there's so many different approaches we can take. Wait. Oh, Raji.
Yep. Yeah. Okay.
No. Don't leave me.
For a sec. I ran away.
Oh, hi. No, do you have stuff to do? No, I just want to.
Oh, you know.
What is the best approach here? How do we bring it all together? I mean, there's so many different angles we can take.
This is true.
I just want to, I didn't see all of them. I'd love some of the development here. So I want to bring
Alan
people
is the
to
OG.
An understanding of what it means to go beyond the human. How
it's
do we
just how
perceive something we cannot conceive?
Look at Alan.
You know,
look
that's
at
the interesting thing. If we know it, it's already integrated. How do we initiate people? And I think everyone's done a really good job of opening people's minds to something new. So just want to give people a sense of the unknown of maybe I'll go with this PowerPoint. Let me just see. Okay, let me see. Do you see my PowerPoint?
Yep.
You have Alex Gray in there. Perfect.
Maybe I'll try this PowerPoint and just see where we can go with that. Anyway.
Okay.
All right, you have stuff to do? Okay, I'll take it.
You got this.
Do you have any questions, though, about...
Well, the theme of today the highest timeline. So I'm curious to see what you have in your slides as I think about, you know, the highest timeline. So,
right. Okay.
Yeah, take it away. I'm listening.
The highest timeline, of course, is being witness to the divine and becoming the transformation as we accept this bigger picture of reality that exists within consciousness. Now, everyone just uses those words, consciousness and reality, but it's a state of being, it's a state of activity, it's a state of ongoing discovery of the unknown. Oh, wait, let me just do slideshow, current slide, presenter view, that's better. Okay, oh, this is a little event that I presented recently, but I want to talk about this guy who was so important for our movement, John Mack. John Mack was a Harvard psychiatrist who said, people are coming to him with abduction experiences and meeting aliens, and that was nothing he could relate to, nothing at all that he could understand. As a psychiatrist, he would think these people are psychotic. And so he did think they were psychotic until he actually met them. And when he met these people who were claiming to have contact, he understood that there was nothing psychologically wrong with them, that they were actually in a way of thinking that was beyond his current worldview. So what his choice was, either I invalidate these people's experiences because it's not my experience, but we can't understand what people are saying here in the old way of looking at reality. So John Mack said, we're dealing with a phenomenon which violates our sense of reality, which operates in the gray area between the physical world and the subjective world. Now, we just think either it's objective or that subjective world is also an objective reality from the point of view of consciousness. Anyway, John goes on to say, we're being asked to prove that this reality exists by methods of physical science alone. But John says, we can't look at the world in terms of mechanics. We have to look at it with a new way of knowing. This is basically John's understanding, a new way of knowing. So some of what John put together, I put in my book, my new book coming out called Making Contact. Here's a little commercial. Well, my book was also a bestseller on Amazon, which is very nice. Here's a little commercial for the book.
Slide 4 out of 146. My person. Alan, you're so vibing with my desires to communicate clearly with a lot of information as much as possible to make clear contact proof of contact. I have a new consensus mechanism invented.
Alan Steinfeld.
Proof of contact.
Prepare to meet advanced civilization that plagued our species for eons to come with them. And by making, we will take our rightful place among the stars.
Anyway, that is just a little commercial for this book where I put together the best people in the field, and I realized they all had a different point of view. All these writers about UFOs, John Mack and Linda Moulton Howe and Whitley Strieber, Nick Pope, Brian Cameron, Carolyn Corey, even Daryl Anka, Mayor. No one was in total agreement. No one really, everyone had a little piece of the puzzle, but nobody had the whole picture. So what was the timeline that we were gonna exist on? What were we really focused on? So let me see if I can actually do a better screen share of this. Let me see. So Linda Moulton Howe is someone I looked at, and what she says is we are really being hampered in our highest timeline because we're kept from the truth. The truth is that we're not alone. We're part of galactic civilization. We're part of an eternal system of thinking and thought. So this is what she says.
That mind-cracking headline, not alone in the universe.
So when we finally, I mean, most of us know on this webinar, we're not alone in the universe, but the consensus reality shifts the consciousness.
Contact.
Here. That's the problem. It's like, we can all believe something's true, but there's such a huge resistance to that we're always fighting for a new timeline within the space of the old timeline. So this is what, so there's timelines that exist within timelines, like fractal timelines. So And we're all living out our own within the context of a bigger picture. It's like different streams that flow into a river, and then that river flows to an ocean. And so all these are, I wouldn't say they're competing timelines. They're timelines that are in our conscious or in subconscious awareness that we get glimpses of. But the predominant timeline is the social consciousness. So I asked her, what did we get this mind, what she calls a mind-cracking headline, we're not alone in the universe, what happens then?
What does that mean for the population of the planet and the civilization? Finally, a truth. As simple as that. If you go back 5,000 years or 12,000 to go back in time,
my computer is not handling my intensity this full moon. I'm not blaming my computer. Unique magazines, never same one in different locations, always different ones in different locations, so that there's a deeper desire of exchanging and digitalizing, if you have to, you know what I mean, in different decentralized forms. But, you know, places where people come to get to know their media scope. OG place. Заліпала я на много часов в Лондоні в таких магазинах. Exclusive. Yeah, I'm gonna have that exclusive. Alan. Can we please have our little time? Are you completely? Yeah, my computer is like, you can.
Satan is abused, because from my point of view, if you are a civilization that evolves for 12,000 years and you're always under the thumb of another intelligence that manipulates you, and that humans are never ever talked to, communicated honestly, then we are today in the 21st century. 12,000 years later, we are an abused species, and part of this abused species is going out into the Milky Way galaxy and beyond without a single general human population knowing and being told we're not alone. Once we do know, what does that mean? What is that? How does that shift our reality? We are finally being given respect enough for the truth of something so huge. We're not only not alone in the universe, and that I would stress, there are other intelligences and they really care about us and they want us to get past this difficult time of lies, deception by other forces that have never told humans the truth. That is why we've got to have this revolutionary headline.
Right. Okay. Okay. Wait, okay. Sorry. And so the idea is, if we do get that, that changes everything, because you may think that you're living in one reality, but we have to look at the bigger picture of everyone in our reality. If we're still seeing war in the world, that's the consciousness we're creating on some level. When there's no longer any, it's not just like you're not reading the newspapers. There really is a planetary shift because of an ascension wave of higher consciousness. That is when, that is the highest timeline, or one of it's the process of revelation. So we have to acknowledge what exists now, and we have to activate through levels of initiation, which means levels of consciousness upgrade, how we're going to access these new realities. So I'm certain that after the dust of centuries have passed over the cities, we too will remember not for our victories or defeats in battle, but for our contribution to the human spirit. So isn't that the highest timeline? What can we contribute to the awareness of spirit and form? That's what I think is our highest potential. So this guy, Tim Burchett, is one guy pushing for disclosure. He's a Republican, and he's from Tennessee. And
this last summer's UFO report, Mr. Speaker, from the Director of National Intelligence was bogus. The report raised more questions than answers about unidentified objects in the skies. It stunk of a government cover-up, Mr. Speaker. Now the Pentagon is starting a new office to collect information on these unidentified objects. The office is called the Airborne Object Identification and Management Synchronization Group. I don't know where they came up with that name. I'm sure they paid somebody a lot of money to come up with that. I do not trust this new office, Mr. Speaker. I don't think it'll be transparent with lawmakers.
La, la, falling away like a moonlight shadow. La, 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 la. Falling away. En voir plus. 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 French people. The most disgusting language. Carriers. Plus. Can't even read you. Because of your language. The way that you don't read half of what you write. So ridiculous language. This is a nice one. Yo, this is very embarrassing that my computer cannot even, you know, I bought computers to two people this year. Invested in their development, that are both of them much more powerful than mine. I invested in them much more money than in my computer, half more than in my computer that I have right now. And what am I experiencing now? My computer not even being able to, you know, channel ETs. Full moon ceremony. Закрыть страницы. That will be a ceremony. No. Я закрою страницы здесь и буду вам читать стихи, которые я пишу прямо сейчас, прямо здесь, чтобы у вас уши были более не глухи. Я сочиняю на ходу, становится все мудрее, а мелодия красивее. So little that makes me happy. It's simply me channeling truth to you. Cheers to me. Мелодия все красивее, когда мы знаем, что мы мудрее. А мы мудрее, и даже лица не совсем виднее. It's not like excellent, but it's definitely notes. And I'm researching mostly covers and names. Of course, prices as well. You know. La 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 la. Yeah, no, I'm making up music on the spot for us. La 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 la. Those are very cute, nice magazine, you know? French people, even though you can't do your language straight and right, you can still do your visual language, that's all I know. That's why I'm working with you so hard. Quantité. Quantité. Never had a desire to learn French. Never. I was like, no, you French. You learn Natalia. Right. Feels la 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 la. I want to look inside of each of them though, but you know what I can do, right? I can search on the website and see which ones have some on. La 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 ya 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 ya. Прикольно.
And country can handle the truth, Mr. Speaker. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield the remainder of my time.
So there's one guy who's obviously looking for answers. I mean, he probably contacted himself. Why else would he stand up on the floor of the Congress saying we demand the truth? Now, of course, the Pentagon did come out with some negative reports that, if we tell you the truth, it might not be fun. So we have a couple of different
sides. It's the most fun truth you can ever imagine.
The part comes to our doors of perception. If doors were cleansed, every time we just see through a small little chink or hole in the fence, in the cavern, we're not seeing the bigger reality because we've been thought controlled by our media, our politicians, our educators, our religion, all those, our parents, all the people who we've learned from have limited our reality. So a conference like this,
ooh, I have this magazine. That's quite nice. And I didn't pay anything for it, of course. That's just what it is. La 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 la.
This allows people to think a little bit more outside the box, because, and you go to this other quote, which is also by William Blake. William Blake was a poet and painter in the 1600s, and so he was a real mystic, and he said, our perceptions are not bounded by our organs of perception. We perceive more than sense ever so acute can discover. When I teach remote viewing, I can see everyone has the ability to see non-locally. That's the incredible thing about knowing that you can remote view. You're not a local consciousness. I hear some background.
Go ahead.
Raji, there were some people in the background there. Okay, I think we're good. Thanks. All right, here we go. The voyage of discovery exists in not seeking the lands, but having the new awareness. What does that mean? It means you have to think outside the box. What is the box? Everything you know. Everything you know is inside the box. How do you think outside the box? Look at things you don't know. Consider the impossible. That is
newer than you.
What seems impossible and being activated to the witness is the divine. When you step back from your personality and observe the world without preference, without judgment, without any kind of sense of what you like and dislike, then the witness to the divine levels of awareness start to come in, and you start to perceive the greater truth. So now let's talk about perception. This picture of an island looks like a horse's head, right? But if you never saw a picture of a horse, you would think this is an island. So if you've never seen an alien or saw a picture or were able to read energy, you wouldn't notice it. You can only recognize something you've already cognized. Cognition means the
background
association of image with identification. So
I saw a picture of Alan in his tub.
Recognize it. So how do you recognize something is by having cognizance, which learns the meaning, the association, the image, and how that shows up in your life. So this is how we go to the next level of cognition. How do we know what ETs look like? Well, we don't. They've seen pictures. We've had people talk about it, but it might not be that way for you. You have to recognize the unknown. Okay, wait. The decisive question for us is, are we related to something infinite or not? Is the key, Carl Jung. Now, Gary Nolan says that DNA, the structure of life, is 9 billion years old, but the Earth is only 4 billion years old. So what does that mean? It means that DNA is primordial. It's part of creation. It's older than the Earth itself. It is the life force and is probably transplanetary. What does Ashley say? Your mind cannot make up anything it has not seen before. Has so much more meaning now that I expand my awareness. I think your mind can make up things, Ashley, that you have seen before. This is what I call the creative imagination. The imagination takes in the unknown. So the only way I'm addressing Ashley in the chat here, realities, is allow your mind to start dreaming, start imagining. It's imagination that leads the way into the unknown. If your mind could only see, your mind cannot make up anything. How would anything new come into the world if your mind can see? This is evolution. This is art. You're make known the unknown, which is what I think our destiny is, making known the unknown. And I'll get back to that. So how do we step out of the matrix? We have to climb out of it with our hands and feet. We have to struggle, get out of the matrix. It is what sucks us into the web of perception. So we start to think like everyone else. We start to perceive what people have told us to perceive. I think one of the best teachers on how to get out of that is Joe Dispenza, because he says, trust what you are creating in your mind over the reality that you're seeing in the world, and then it becomes true for you.
So true.
Yeah, you can climb out of your matrix, but you might be climbing into a new matrix unless you are living in the unknown. So most people are not even aware anything else exists around them. I think this is an actual stop sign yield for people looking at their iPhones there. But are we about to leap into a new fishbowl with more fish? I think so. I think we are. Our true eternal nature is much more encompassing than our concepts of time and space in which we define ourselves. So we think time and space are universal. But what if you close your eyes and start to go within? Then time and space change, but consciousness is still present. That's the thing. Consciousness is not dictated by time and space, even though it seems like it is. So the going within process creates the doorways to infinite realities. There's an infinite reality outside of us and inside of us. And somehow we are the beings between the inner and outer. The remembrance of our eternal nature, our purpose for being incarnate on Earth, is for one purpose. One purpose we're here for. That's why you've come into the body. It's not to get a great job and make lots of money and do all those things. There's another reason, I think, this is just my opinion and from what I've learned, is to make known the unknown. That is why you incarnated, to perceive what you have not already seen, to imagine a greater reality. This is why art, creativity, and imagination are the evolutionary impulses. It's hardwired inside of us to be connected to the flow of creation as it pours through each one of us every single moment. The universal mind matrix is flowing into the receiver of your mind consciousness vehicle. Every moment, if you step out of the known and into the unknown, you are downloading new realities. The idea is to free fall into the unknown. It's not easy because you always want to grab onto what you know. But if you can do that, then you start to bring in new levels of perception. You know, if you ask anyone who started to do channeling, at some point, they just had to let go.
Right.
And let go of what their mind said, let go of the known, and start to just bring in the information as they are being downloaded to it. That's what is part of the evolutionary timeline, the fact that we all have access to these other levels of reality, that everyone can channel these higher level beings and our higher parts of ourselves. So that's it. Now, Socrates, the most influential thinker in Western history, said it's the artist that is the key to our evolution. He didn't say that. I'm saying that. For the artist is a light and winged holy thing. There's no invention in them until one has been inspired and is out of their senses and mind, is no longer they're no longer part of their personality. The gods take away the minds of the creators and use them as ministers and holy prophets, so that we who see their work know it not for the individual self, not for the name and person, but for the infinite flow of creation that came through. Like, you know, Bob Dylan was asked, where did your songs come from? He said, I don't know where they came from. They just came. So the really great artists, and those are the beings that are making known the unknown, and we're evolving civilization because of art, I think, or the creative action, are those that are able to step out of the way and allow the state of the divine transmission to come through. That was in the dialogues of Plato, where Socrates asked this poet, you know what makes your poetry so great? And he said, yeah, it's the way I say the words, it's my idea, it's all that. Socrates says, no, it's none of those things. It's when you're not there. It's when your mind is given over to the gods. That is what is so great about your poetry. Anyway, I say, be the artist of consciousness. Your picture of reality is the most important creation. Make it powerfully profound and beautiful. This is the work of Alex Gray. Well, I don't know where these images came from. He doesn't know, maybe, I don't know, but it came to him. And because it came to him, we're able to perceive new levels of awareness, because I think, and it doesn't matter what your art is, whatever you're bringing through from the unknown is adding to the upgrade to create the highest timeline. It is about that. It's about the levels of non-understanding, actually. It's not about understanding, it's about going beyond understanding. Any experience that does not conform to our categories perception of reality will not be real for us. Now, this is the barrier we have to go beyond. We have to realize that there are levels of perception that are not real in the sense of consensus reality. What makes something real is when enough people say it's real. What makes it real for you is your experience. So if you have an ET experience, or you meet a being, or you have this dream, do you believe what other people are saying is real, or do you trust your experience? That is the juncture we're at now. If you tell someone, I had this incredible experience, I saw these beings, I was taken aboard the ship, they may or may not believe you. But if they don't believe you, does that mean it's less real for you? Or do we have to believe our own experience first before we ask other people for confirmation? Yeah, it's great to meet people who will confirm. Yeah, I think that happened to me. Or people just say, no, you're crazy. You don't know what you're talking about. So, you know, I say most people aren't crazy. I say most people have genuine experiences. And I think you can spot the crazy ones. The crazy ones are the ones that are very ego-based. They're very dogmatic. They want to tell everyone this is real. And it doesn't matter what you think. The ones that have true experiences, the people I know who have had true experiences, are usually like shy about sharing it. They don't necessarily, they don't even trust what's happened to them. My job is to confirm that, to trust people's experience. What I wanna do is tell people that if you've experienced it, it's a reality. So what I do on my new reality show is collect a lot of about other people to confirm a new collective reality. And that's another level of how we shift timelines, is by confirming each other's experience with our experience. You know, doesn't mean your experience real if you're the only person that's saying it, but if enough people come forward and share an experience, it's further. But trust your experience is the message here. It doesn't matter what anyone says. No longer will the dualistic mind directly and indirectly interpret spiritual language and proto-communication as simplified linear planetary level of life and death. This is J.J. Hertog in Key 406. We have to think beyond duality, and we have to think beyond linear progression. So multiple levels of reality are coming to us all at once. So timelines are flowing through us all the time. That makes sense. But so we are always in a choice of which stream are we taking. But let's notice all the streams of energy that's coming to, all the streams of possible realities. That's the best level, that's the best multi-dimensional position to be in, is notice everything you notice. So I think of art, and I keep going back to art because art is not just painting. Art is where the flow of creation starts to enter the conscious and subconscious mind. So think of art as a distant early warning system that can always be relied on to tell the old culture what is beginning to happen. So the new ideas, Picasso said, if it's known, it's already old. The new ideas, the new phenomena, new possibilities is what everyone in their art form is here to create at the highest level of their abilities. That's my belief. So let's see what else. The great artist is synonymous with the great intelligence. The artist is the vehicle of the most delicate and most invisible sensations of the brain. This was a symbolist poet in the 1840s, 1850s. The symbolist really led a revolution in bringing in a kind of modern day spirituality into art. I mean, there was religious art from the Renaissance and, you know, the Middle Ages, but there was the French symbolists that then spread out to Berlin and London and all that, started to bring an awareness of spirit in. And then there were the poets as well, and Whitman comes to mind, and so many other of these people. So, you know, so what is true here? This picture on the right is called the, it's probably more pictures, but each little dot in this picture is a galaxy. And there are trillions of galaxies with trillions of stars in every galaxy. So how can we be the center of creation? That is the big question, right? And you know what? We are the center of creation, and we are not the center of creation. We are both the center and not the center. So how do we live with that duality? simple. Stop thinking linearly. We are the center and not the center. Just think of it as and both and. It's not either or, it's both and. It's living the duality. We are the center of creation and not the center of creation, all at once. How do we understand that? Well, you don't understand that with your linear mind. There's no way to understand that with your linear mind. So that is what we have to understand. We have to go beyond linear thinking. And so this was a picture I got from the Ramtha School. So we involuted from the highest point to point zero beyond time and space into levels of density until we got to the first level of density. And now we're evolving back to point zero. It's also represented in the chakras. Most people live out of their first and second and third chakra, but as evolution and ascension happens, we start to live out of the heart, the expression, the awareness, the all-wise knowing consciousness. So that is also represented in the brain. The lower cerebellum is the animal consciousness. The neocortex, the new consciousness, is where the new thoughts come into the right brain. So all of this, the involution and the evolution from the point of God creation that we all descended from, is in our bodies and it's in the vehicle of consciousness, which may or may not be in your brain. I don't know. It's not simple to say that we exist in the world with other intelligent beings. When contact is finally integrated into our culture, it will create an acceleration in the emergence of the new human mind, creating a vaster reach of human creativity. That is what a Starseed conference is about. It's about building the momentum here that we are galactic. We're humans and galactics. We're part of a bigger neighborhood. We're not just, you know, earthlings or New Yorkers or Americans. We're part of the galactic consciousness itself. And that will generate higher levels of vaster levels of awakening. Now is the time of knowledge meeting, so that we can allow new beingness to enter us. That was Whitley Strieber's communion. Okay. Oh, this is H.G. Wells, who said, "A time will come when people will sit with history before them or some old newspaper and ask incredulously, was there ever such a world?" He said that in 1938, before like the whole horrors of World War II happened. But yeah, was there ever such a world where people would invade other countries? I mean, do we even need countries, really? And, you know, shoot people. I mean, was there ever such a world? Well, you know, there is that world, but we're evolving out of it. We are. That's why we all need to hold the highest, most positive frequency vibration, because I think Raji said, thoughts are things. They are things, or someone said that today. And lots of people have said that. But that means your thoughts actually do affect the reality around you. And so this is a thought, that you are infinite. To see a world in a grain of sand and heaven in a wildflower, hold infinity in the palm of your hand and eternity in an hour. That's William Blake talking about the infinite nature of being. That is our destiny. So because this is the Starseed conference, I really wanted to go back to where I think actually probably the first person to talk about starseeds was Ken Carey. This is a channel book, and this really set the foundation for, I would say, the Starseed movement. And it was published in 91, but he got the transmission and it says, during a cold and snowy period of 11 days, December 27, 1978 to January 1979, the whole material was recorded, and he didn't publish it for maybe, what was that, 12 years or something? In the years that have passed since those 11 winters.
I know those unpublished things.
He said his little office was pulsating with the rhythm of some alien yet hauntingly familiar intelligence. I've given thought a number of times of publication, yet my life at the time was full of momentum. But eventually he did publish this book, which is still incredibly relevant to what we're talking about now. In the Starseed Transmission says, when you remember your true nature and begin to draw your identity of your being, you begin to draw identity from the totality of your being, which is not your personality or your name or your history. That is not your true nature. When you start to draw on the totality, transactivated intelligence, then it can be stated with all validity that this voice that talked to him, I am an element of your own consciousness. So this is what he channeled for Starseed's transmission, that this voice was actually a part of his higher consciousness. But it's a part of all our consciousness when we understand our true nature. However, at this point, you will no longer perceive me as you do now, which is the separate voice that he started to channel. When you have awakened to the reality of your true yourself, until then you perceive me, or that voice that came to him, as being outside yourself. All these beings, this whole world, everything you see around you, I think, is inside you. But it's not inside your brain or your mind. It's inside what we're calling consciousness, because consciousness is the true totality of your being. I don't know how many people understand that. So when you define yourself without regard to your internal presence out of which the universe unfolds, this is also Ken Carey, means that the universe unfolds from within you. And when we continue to play out the variations of human history, meaning that we're subject to the emotionalities of the history, this keeps our eternal spirit at bay by imagining greater beings than us in the cosmos. There are no good news and bad news for people who are, there are no.
There are no news. Only new philosophers. I really do question the depth of these publications. Even the new philosopher. I don't know why I'm questioning the depth of a new philosopher, but maybe it's the energy that I'm tuning into.
Stuff. I don't need to see inside of your magazine to see inside of your magazine.
Greater being, and the illusions of the material existence silence the awareness of our spirit. There are no greater beings than you. Each one of you that are listening, you are the ultimate being, truly, truly, truly. And
broccoli.
You know that. When I know Sarash, that, we'll no
broccoli
longer have to
у нас do есть журнал.
We'll just know it. We'll just be it. We'll just,
I had a company
we'll just understand that level
idea.
Of consciousness. So.
That I worked on, it's called
time.
Broccoli.
When the emotionality of indulgent thoughts define us without reference to the sources and the forces that were intended to connect our eternal spirit to experience of our physical atomic structure, bind and limit our perception. So when we get overly emotional, which is how most people are, they're always in some kind of triggered response, that defines them. Their emotions define them. And when your emotions define you, you're no longer the observer of the emotions. I'm not saying don't have the emotions. I'm just saying don't let the emotions run you. Because when you let the emotions run you, then the reason for the emotions, which was to connect experience to spirit, that's the reason for emotion, like we're having feelings, and it's to connect the incarnational experience to the eternal spirit. It's like the emotions are the vehicle of perception, actually, of spirit incarnate. So emotions, I would say there's people who get stuck on certain emotions. I actually call it feelings. And the feelings are the eternal process of the ongoing revelations of incarnational experience. Every moment is a feeling. Yeah, there's some moments where you can feel these fantastic or maybe not so fantastic emotionalities, but the emotionalities are a stuck movement in time. So back to this last line, our infinite vision of creation is consumed by the myths beneath the myths of excessive emotional field keeps us trapped in the emotionality, which is great to have emotion, but flow with it. There is a thin veil between us and the full dimensional perceptions of our eternal self. We require no elaborate technique or ritual to release this veil. So we need only to open to the organic current of awareness that flows into our consciousness every moment of existence. Only now, only here. And can we do that? Can we let go of our history? Can we let go of our personality? Can we let go of what we like and don't like and the people we're attached to or not attached to, the people we don't like? I mean, can we let go of everything and be in the current awareness of the flow of history, of the flow of the moment as it kind of streams through our consciousness? That is the ultimate incarnational experience and the ultimate timeline. When we can do that, then we stop... kind of control the flow of the timeline, because the natural flow of the timeline is for its highest level. It's just people get in the way and want to control the course of the river. But by flowing with it, it is the most direct path to the highest reality. That's what I think anyway. When we live in the awareness of the life force, we're no longer defined by the static images of yesterday's history, but in the ongoing participation of creation. That's what it's like to be the artist. The artist of creation is in the ongoing participation of the onflow of consciousness. So when we know ourselves as witness of the divine's forever presence, then in this great purpose brings the joy to all dimensions of existence. We create the world with our minds, like the Buddhist teaching. The world is inside your mind, but not the limited human mind. It's in the vastness of consciousness that's way beyond your brain, way beyond existence. Let me just see. When we define ourselves in the separation of survival, we are deceived. We get locked into the very small perception of reality. If you're basing your existence on survival, then you're missing the greater portion of reality. Cultural illusions become the reality, preventing the greater witness from seeing fantastic worlds. So it's like we see through this dark mirror as opposed to this really clear window into the outside world as reality starts flowing into moment-to-moment conscious awareness. The apparitions of fear intervene between us and spirit, cutting us off from our eternal origins, leaving us in a diminished sense of self. So that's it. Are you living in fear? Are you living in love? I know that's cliche, but that's one thing. Are we playing with time, or is time playing with us? That's what I want to know. Okay, how much more time do I have here? Speaking of time, hello, anybody? Raji, I'll keep going.
You're good. Like a couple of minutes.
Like what, 5 minutes?
Yeah, around.
Okay, thanks. Okay. 5 minutes. Okay. So as we move into fifth dimensional awareness, things like near-death experience, out-of-body experience, UFOs, past life, and these are all become acceptable and the reality of our world. So one way to get into that is to overcome left-brain thinking. This is what we're born with on the right. This is the great imagination. By the time you're 5 years old, you are put into a box and you're told to think this way. There's nothing wrong with ABC 123, but that is not the totality of reality. The totality of reality is all the other things on the other side. Let me just turn out of this PowerPoint there. It's everything else on the other side of reality. Okay, let me just get to the most important slides here. Okay. Okay, here we go. I'm just gonna go here and just share the screen. All right, let me do a little quick update here, screen share. Okay,
there it is. I wanna go to each website of this publication. Is that possible?
Okay.
Can we manifest that?
So we do have to think beyond time and space, right? You have to think, we have to think in this ultimate reality, as M.T. Escher did, where up is down and down is up, in is out and out is in. And the infinite flow of consciousness does come through, I think, our right brain awareness, which is more connected to the infinite flow of creation than your left brain, which just is local awareness. There's non-local and local awareness. It's how people can remote view. Looking for consciousness in the brain is like looking inside the radio for the announcer. You know, the radio breaks. It doesn't mean the announcer stops doing what he's doing or the music stops playing. No, we are non-local awareness. The yin and yang, I'll go over that. Let's just see. My brain is only a receiver in the universe, which is core from which my gift, take knowledge, strength, and inspiration. I have not penetrated the secrets of the core, but I know it exists. This is Tesla, 1909. So are we looking down at the chessboard or up at the chessboard? The idea is to transcend duality. That's the idea here. You know, I'll go into more of this. We are asleep. Our life is a dream, but we wake up sometimes just enough to know that we're dreaming. That's, if we can have that realization, then we start to think of the bigger realities that we can come to. The limits of my language means the limits of my world. Well, no, I just said it doesn't. Language is only a thought form limitation for the mind to kind of think inside a box. No, we are thinking outside of language all the time with these greater realities. For instance, the dolphin's brain, much more complex than the human brain. Dolphins can emit more than one language at a time, more than one sound at a time. Humans are really trapped in a very small, even the human brain is only taught to use half its brain. We're only taught to think on one side of our brain. Dolphins think are always awake, either on one side